Good evening, everyone. I love Psalm 145. This is a chapter that I read often, and I really see something new in this passage. Every time I read it, the Holy Spirit shows me something new in this passage. So let me read this. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. And this week, I really connected with that last verse. As I read all of these others, I think every time I read that before, those ideas seemed kind of separate, but this week, they came together. And I was reminded that God's greatness, we see that in his compassionate slowness to anger. We see his compassion in how he is rich in love. So let's sing of that greatness and that love tonight with How Great Thou Art.
My God, how great thou art.
tonight on God's greatness, the goodness of his deeds toward us, we remember that he has shown us that he is faithful and will remain faithful to us no matter what. So let's sing together all three verses of Great is Thy Faithfulness. The song portion of tonight's service, let's take the opportunity to reflect on God's grace, greatness as we sing verses 1, 3, and 4 of Holy, Holy, Holy.
Early in the morning, our song shall rise. Well, thank you, Katie, Rebecca, Chuck, so much for that this evening. I hope that you've had a good day, and let's start right off with a word of prayer, please. Merciful Father in heaven, as we are before you again this evening, we're thankful for the blessings, for your greatness, for your faithfulness, and for your love. Your holiness is beyond our comprehension, and because of that, we trust in your word. We commit our lives to your grace and power. And I pray this evening that your Holy Spirit would once again be given a chance to come into our hearts and our minds and speak to us according to the message that is contained here in this songbook of Israel. Lord, may we have eyes that are fresh, ears that are tender, as we listen to your Spirit speak to us of the glorious goodness of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Be finding Psalm 73. And the writer of this psalm, he begins with a conclusion. And that's not normal, but that's how he does it. And a preacher asked his buddy one time, he said, "What makes a good sermon?" And his friend said, "A good introduction and a good conclusion as close together as possible." And I like that definition. Now this man, this psalmist, has thought about this, and he is saying, surely God is good. And I want you to remember that. God is good in all the time. Now what the devil wants you to do is he wants you to get thinking negatively about God. And if the devil can get you thinking negatively about God, then he's opened you up to all kind of mayhem and mischief. Remember, the devil is a liar. God is good and all the time. He also begins with a confession. Now the confession is here in verse 2. But as for me, my feet came close to stumbling, my steps had almost slipped. That is, I was almost backslidden. Slipped away from God, turned from the faith. He had been thinking, does it really pay to serve Jesus? Is life really fair? My message tonight, I titled that, When Life Doesn't Seem Fair, and a lot of people are thinking that recently. This psalmist was saying, is life really fair? I want to serve God, I endeavor to serve God, and what good has it done for me? Sometimes we can reach that point. We're tired, disappointed, disillusioned, and so I want you to see four things tonight. First of all, he saw the prosperity of the sinners. Look at verse 3. For I was envious of the arrogant as I saw the prosperity of the wicked. He's envious of fools. Now listen to me. Only a fool envies fools. But he confessed it. Remember, he's a believer. He's been serving God, and he looks at these people and he sees their plenty. He sees their possessions. Now let me say this. Not all godly people are poor. And not all wicked people are rich, but that's what this man has his eyes on. He's just picked out some prosperous, wicked people, and he set his eyes on them. And then he sees their peace. Look in verse 4. For there are no pains in their death, and their body is fat. They come to the deathbed, and you might expect to see them crying out wiggling or being real agitated. Nope. They just die with a smile on their face. Well, Bruce, that doesn't make sense. I mean, don't they know that as they're approaching death and they're going to meet God, that would really make them squirm? No. You see, a man may not fear dying because he doesn't know what living is. He doesn't understand the judgment. And then he sees their pride. Look in verse 6. Therefore, pride is their necklace. The garment of violence covers them. They wear pride like a gold chain. They are so arrogant, they can strut sitting down. And then they see their pleasures. Look at verse 7. Their eye bulges from fatness. Their imaginations of their heart run riot. They've got stuff in the garage. They've got stuff in the attic. They've got stuff in the closets. They've got money in the bank. Here I am trying to serve God, and I live paycheck to paycheck, and these people that don't care about God, they've got money to blow. I mean, I'm supposed to be a believer. So where's all the cash and the Cadillacs that the guys on TV are promising me? And then it's compounded by their perversity. Look in verse 8. They mock and wickedly speak of oppression. They speak from on high. In other words, they're rotten through and through. And then he sees their pomposity. I don't even know if that's a word. You know, sometimes I got words that aren't words, or I got words that got a Yiddish meaning to them, and who knows what's going on there. But they're pompous. Look in verse 9. They have set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue parades through the earth. These are the people with a walking tongue. They have absolutely no fear of God in the eyes. And so many wicked people today, you just can't believe it. They know they're out of touch with God, and they don't care. And then he sees their profanity. Look at verses 9 through 12. They've set their mouth against the heavens. Their tongue parades through the earth. Therefore, his people return to this place, and waters of abundance are drunk by them. They say, how does God know? And is there knowledge with the Most High? Behold, these are the wicked, and always at ease they have increased in wealth. If you're not careful, you could become like this man. You're going to take your eyes off of Jesus and put your eyes on the sins of those for whom our Savior died. You're going to begin to think negatively about God, and your feet are going to slip if you're not careful. I can remember. I've seen it. Men and women of God that something negative happens in their life and they take their eyes off of Jesus and they begin to look around at other people and they feel like God has cheated them because they've lost something valuable and important in their life, and wicked people aren't experiencing that. And so they just throw up their hands and turn their back on God. So the second thing I want you to hear tonight is the problems of the saint. You know, if the sinner prospered and the saint did too, well, that might be different. But look now in verse 13. Surely in vain I've kept my heart pure and washed my hands in innocence. Now, what's this man? He's beginning to look inward. He's beginning to feel sorry for himself. He's egocentric rather than Christ-centered. And why is he feeling sorry for himself? Well, first of all, he had had a cleansed life. It's not that he was harboring sin in his heart. He said, I've done all the right things, but what has it gotten me? But not only that, he also had a chastened life. Look in verse 14. I've been stricken all day long and chastened every morning. You would think that if a man loved God and served God, had his life clean, living with a clear conscience, that God would be pouring out his blessings upon him. But he said, I don't get blessing, I get chastening. Every morning it begins again. He's expecting joy and happiness, and it doesn't come. Well, why? Well, you need to learn this. This is a lesson that you probably don't hear often because it's not a popular one. But I gave an unpopular message this morning, so I'm on a roll here. Let me give you this. God deals with the devil's crowd by credit, but God's children by cash. What? God deals with the devil's crowd by credit, but God's people by cash. Now, what's that mean? Well, if you're a child of God, he's going to chastise you whenever you need it. That chastisement might be a correcting chastisement if you've done something wrong, or maybe a chastisement to cause you to grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus. It may be a discipline. Many times we see clearly only through eyes that have been washed by tears. And sometimes God will chastise us because we've done wrong. It's not a sign that he doesn't love us. In fact, it's a sign that he does love us. Now, don't ever forget that. Because how does God deal with the devil's crowd? Does God step in and chastise them? No. As a matter of fact, he often just leaves them alone. In Romans chapter 1, three times it says, and God gave them up. He just said, oh, go. Do what you want. I'm finished. But now turn over to Romans chapter 2 and verse 5. See, in Romans 1, God turns away. He just steps away from them. He doesn't chastise them. But in Romans 2, 5, he says, but because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you're storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. You're just putting wrath in the bank until judgment day, and one day the judgment comes. Now, you may be an unsaved person listening in tonight, and you say, well, look, that doesn't make any sense, preacher, because I am not what you'd call a religious person. I'm listening in on this because I'm curious, but my life is good right now. I'm not having the struggles that I see Christians having. That's because God's not going to touch you if you're not one of his. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. Listen, my dad played a lot of baseball and a lot of softball when I was a kid. That was way back. They still had baseball teams. For men, like they've got slow pitch. It was baseball then, and then he played on a fast pitch softball team, and he would often take me along. I think maybe my mom bribed him or paid him or something just to get me out of the house, but away I went. And after a while, I would wander off with the other kids, and before you knew it, there would be a disagreement about the rules that we were for whatever it was that we were playing. And to this day, I don't know how he did it, but right during the game, he'd show up. we'd be fighting with kids, and there he was. And he'd grab a hold of me, and he always disciplined me. The kid that was causing all the trouble, the kid that was fighting, the kid that was cursing, the kid that was the troublemaker, the kid that was at fault, my dad didn't touch him. But he'd spank me and he'd haul me back to the dugout or make me sit in the bleachers. And you see, here's the biblical principle. You don't whip the neighbor's kids. You don't do it. You don't touch them because they're not yours. And if you're a child of God, do you see what I'm trying to tell you? If you're a child of God, he's going to chasten, discipline you. But if you're not, he's not going to touch you. But then, this psalmist, he had a confused life. He couldn't understand it. And this is what he says in verses 15 and 16. If I had said, I will speak thus, behold, I would have betrayed the generation of your children. When I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome in my sight. He didn't have any place to go or anybody to turn to. He's battling this loneliness. He's discouraged, but he doesn't know who to talk to because he's a believer. And it would be like me standing up in front of you all and telling you that, I'm finished with the Christian faith. I'm done being a Christian. I mean, that would offend. That would discourage. That would shock all of you. So the psalmist doesn't know what to do. So let's go to the third thing that he saw, the perspective of the sanctuary. Look at verse 17. Until I came into the sanctuary of God, then I perceived their end. Here's what he's done. He's gone into the house of God, and there he gets a brand new perspective. You know what I believe was wrong with this believer, this psalmist, this writer? I believe for one thing, he'd been missing the religious services, the worship services. I believe he'd been missing the assembly of God. You know, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25, we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. And I've read comments from people that say, you know, I don't know what the big deal is about churches being shut down. I don't know what the big deal is about going to church. You know, the church is not a building, the church is people. Yeah, I get that. They're absolutely right. But there's something about meeting together. You are richer, stronger, full of faith more, having been with one another. Just the praise, to hear the music, to meet a brother, or to meet a sister, to see a smile, just to feel the glory of God between one another. There's something about the perspective of the sanctuary that's wonderful. And so this man, this psalmist now, when he has the perspective of the sanctuary, he says, brother, I was so foolish. Look in verse 21. When my heart was embittered and I was pierced within, then I was senseless and ignorant. I was like a beast before you. He just says, I'm ashamed of myself for thinking that way. And then let's go on to the final thing here. When life doesn't seem fair, you might look around and see the prosperity of the sinners, the problems of the saints, but you get to the perspective of the sanctuary, and then you end up rejoicing in the presence of the Savior. Oh, as he ends this psalm, this is a wonderful psalm. It's such a blessing. He begins to think about what he has. Oh, look at verse 23. Nevertheless, all of that discouragement, and then he gets to verse 23. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You've taken a hold of my right hand. See, there is the personal presence of God. I can't imagine being anywhere else or having anything else but Jesus. I mean, his presence, thank God for his presence. Our dear Savior says, lo, I am with you. There is the personal presence of God. You know, it was 8 years ago today that my mom passed away. And my two sisters and I were in the hospital. My sister's husband and Jeannie, all five of us were there. And my mom was writhing in pain and agony. And I had to preach the next day. So that was the 30th. Jeannie and I came home. And she died early in the morning of the 31st. But you know, there was a peace that filled us because of the personal presence of God. And he always is with us, even through the roughest of times. And then there's the personal power of God. Look again in verse 23. I have seen God bring me through so many things. I've been in the located ministry for 45 years. Jeannie and I have been, we celebrated 25 years at Plainfield Christian just this past Mother's Day. And the power that he has given me in my life all of these years. I've seen miracles. I've seen extraordinary things. I've seen people's lives change remarkably because of his power. And next, there is the purpose of God. Look in verse 24. With your counsel, you will guide me, and afterward, receive me to glory. When I got into the ministry, I understood that there was a purpose for that, and that was to find people that needed to have a relationship with Jesus. I know in some places, in some churches, they do a lot of moving the sheep from one pen to the other. But I've always thought that what God expected from me was to find the lost, to be evangelistic. God has taught me that we're to look people through the eyes and understand that not only does He love them, but without the saving blood of Jesus, they are lost for eternity. One of the things that has been remarkable about the church is the strength and the love and the encouragement that you get. Way back when I was, I was about the fifth grade, we had a preacher and his family decide to leave and take a ministry in Colorado. And so the church had a great big potluck for them to say our goodbyes. And even all these years later, I'll never forget how many tears were shed, the crying of people begging them, even though they'd already taken the job, begging them not to go. The ministries that Jeannie and I have left, people were begging us not to go. I think about the time when her and I leave this place. Oh, the joy. I'm not sure they'll be begging us to stay, but anyways, it was that sense of love among the family of God that was so instrumental in making me want to go into the ministry. And I wish that I could just explain it more eloquently to all of you tonight. That when God is in our life and we struggle with this life not being fair, that we stop looking around us and start looking above us, because there God is so consistent, He is so faithful, and He just stays by us. Because the last thing is the promise of God. With your counsel you will guide me, and afterward receive me to glory. We're going to heaven. When you think you can't go any further, or when you're afraid about the next step, or you're concerned about your future, just remember this. This world is not our home. We're going to glory. And now he comes to a conclusion, beginning in verse 25. Whom have I in heaven but you, and beside you I desire nothing on earth. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For behold, those who are far from you will perish. You have destroyed all those who are unfaithful to you, but as for me, the nearness of God is my good. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of your works. Friend, let me tell you something. It pays to serve Jesus. Don't let the devil get you to thinking negatively about God. Take your eyes off of these people that have no concept of the future. They're just living this life because this life is all they have to live for. Don't be envious. Don't be envious of them. It pays every day to serve Jesus. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we talk about it, and it's easier to say than it is to live. When we're involved, engulfed in daily living, it has a tendency to wear on us, to tear us down. And that's why I praise you tonight for the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Father God, we have an advantage that the world can't understand. And when you talk about a peace that passeth understanding, you're talking about the power that resides in our soul. He is so tremendous because He is God. And when we have Him working in our lives, Father, when we allow Him to take charge and to take control, He can rescue us. He may not change our circumstances, but He changes our attitude, and from that we can be victorious. I pray this week, as we encounter things and problems that in the past would upset us, that we can remember your great faithfulness, and we can rise above, trusting in you, in Jesus' name. Amen.